We had energy, belief, and a mission, but we were already fully mature people, families. We had, most of us had already reputations in our professions. So it wasn't as if we came together as people who, gee, let's do this. We had some maturity among us.
As much as we were mature, first of all, we or each one came from a different background and a different view of the future. We all were afraid. Are we entitled to be analysts? And the fear and the insecurity, can we be analysts? Can we build an institute? Was projected into mistrust, into each other. Are you the right person to become the analyst? Well, it was basically our inner fears of, can we be the analyst? If you remember, one of the subjects that we discussed more than any other subject was, who will be the train, who are the training analysts in the group? And who is entitled to be? We discussed and discussed and discussed. I must say, I wondered then, and I see it now repeat. It's repetitive. That's the same problem that exists today.
Well, but the solution is, that happened in my living room. I lived on Warner Avenue. And we decided that each person, we would trust each other enough, each person to declare whether they had the qualifications and potential to be a training analyst. Mm-hmm. And that was a victory.
That was a victory, the first victory in the attempt to become united as an institute. Mm-hmm. But I am saying that was our main struggle. And I think that covered so many other struggles, and including the fear of each one of us. Am I an analyst? I felt I am. Are the others an analyst? And that was a lot of fear involved.
I felt certainly I can analyze candidates, and certainly I've done supervision of all kinds. But I did not feel the training analyst had a real sort of a magical concept. I mean, that you were different. You were somehow a very special person in the hierarchy, and I didn't feel that I was, and it took about 2 years before I finally decided this was a lot of nonsense.
Doing my thing, based upon all that I accepted and respected from my training, patched together made me the analyst. The other guy patched it together differently. I don't know how better he was, but it didn't bother me that he patched it differently, okay? Because I don't think there's a standardized image of the analyst.
There was always something new coming on, so I knew that I would never know all that I needed to know, that there was always going to be something else coming along that I wasn't yet familiar with, and that was part of the excitement. So I can't say I had supreme confidence that I could do it, but I did have confidence that I could learn to do it.
We all carried some personal frustrations. We all, you all, and I would say we all, were trained illegally. You were not trained as training analysts. You were trained by people that were training analysts. But many people, and I assume you, didn't go to a person because he is a training analyst. You went to analysis.
Absolutely. But, you know, mm-hmm. If you can step back, each of us, and I have to agree completely with you, I had no sense ever that I could be an analyst, be accepted as an analyst. No sense at all. It came to me most clearly, not when the IPA accepted us, but when the IPA looked at our candidates and said, you know, you have the best group of candidates we have ever met, that's when I knew that I was an analyst. Mm-hmm.
From different worlds, disciplines, and schools of thought, they banded together. shut out of the establishment, the founders of the Los Angeles Institute and Society for Psychoanalytic Studies were not deterred in their perseverance or purpose to create the first non-medical, truly interdisciplinary, and egalitarian analytic institute. Each in his or her own way was in search of psychoanalysis. Each was compelled by a deep need to understand the human condition. In that spirit, they found each other and came together as a pioneering group to light a candle.
Psychoanalysis wasn't a youthful passion of mine. My first encounter with it was a play of Eugene O'Neill's. I was in high school. Mourning Becomes Electra. And I didn't know I was getting involved in psychoanalysis. I'd always been interested in literature, and it was a special English class in high school. But I never forgot that play.
Dr. Ernest Lawrence, born and bred in New York, has always been at the center of the arena, fighting the good fight. During his term as president of Division 39, Ernie spearheaded the antitrust suit against the International Psychoanalytical Association and the American Psychoanalytic Association. Even as a young man, he grasped the interrelationship between the psychic and the socio-political struggle for freedom. For most of his life, he has battled against internal and external oppression, confident that psychoanalysis holds the power to liberate us.
I'd gotten very much involved, though, politically. It was during Depression times, and I got very much involved politically with all the kind of youth movements that were going on then. Sit-down strikes and that sort of stuff. And when I got to City College, they had a great hall, and that was called the Great Hall. It was kind of a Gothic cathedral. And there was a meeting, it was packed. And the meeting was Freud and Marx, psychoanalysis or Marxism. And here it is, 1937. I was not even quite 17 yet. And I'm in college, and they're having this meeting. And I was just exhilarated. I never thought that the personal, internal feelings had anything to do with social concerns, social commitments. And I got really exhilarated at that point. And after a few years of college, I went to night school, I went to the Army, and the Army I started to read again. And when I got out of the Army, I had a choice of going into engineering, I was up at Cornell, and sometimes I think I should have gone into engineering. I saved myself a lot of trouble, made a lot of money, but I chose to go into psychology and psychoanalysis. And that's when I escaped New York and came to University of Southern California. I really never gave any thought to being an analyst. I thought I'd be a psychologist, work as a psychologist, and sort of incorporate analytic thinking. I got active in, as I always do, in psychological politics, and became very active in the California Psychological Association. And I actually was president in 1970, just about the time the Institute was formed, And I think I was looking for a home. And that's when the idea of the Institute began. It's interesting to look at that time. It was a time when medical analysis was so firmly established, so entrenched, and so hostile and foreign to lay people. Here I go, I call myself a lay person. I had a PhD already, but I was a lay person. But that's the kind of communication that went on. Personal friends, fine. But professional colleagues, no. And I remember we're talking about starting an institute. And literally, they laughed. You had to lie. I got supervision doing analysis. I got an analysis. but it was all under the table. You felt safe, can I say? Not right. And I always felt uncomfortable, actually, in the analysis, one way or another. Although my analyst was good and was helpful, useful. And the people that supervised me said, look, Ernie, these are sad times. We're willing to do it, but you can't broadcast this. The Institute started in this hostile atmosphere, and it's sort of, we had meetings and talked about it, but it sort of started, I don't know, almost like a flower pops up out of the ground. And we didn't know quite what to do with it. I think we finally learned. But it took a while because we didn't want to go like the other institutes around. We didn't want to have a kind of a lockstep. You know, in the medical institutes at that time, you never questioned an instructor. Literally, never questioned. They said something, that was it. And most of us came out of different disciplines. Most of us were psychologists. And that isn't how we've been brought up. That isn't how we were taught. We were taught to question. We wanted a different form, some different shape, some format, or even just the texture of it to be different from the medical institutes. We stumbled onto a way of working. It's hard to recapture those times without some feeling of real pain, actually. What was true is that we were all enamored of psychoanalysis. It was, to us, a way of thinking, a way of helping, a way of seeing the world. We were absorbed in literature. We used to talk about books, and we never... It was a different way of thinking about life. I just laughed because it just occurred to me that I was the founding president, and they gave me, you know, usual thing they give a president, where everybody writes something, and you know, it's very nice. And someone wrote in the last, everybody signed it. And the last signature someone wrote, Sigmund Freud, he would have approved. I tell you, I can almost choke up now thinking of that, because I think he would have, actually would have approved, because psychoanalysis is supposed to be a revolutionary movement. Psychoanalysis, like art, is supposed to stir you, bug you, bother you. It's supposed to put something inside of you that you can't be just comfortable with yourself. It's not to remove symptoms. It's not to just make the world look okay. It's not to be just simply adaptive. It's nice to have that on along the way. But like art, it's supposed to get inside your gut and wrench you and make you look at things inside yourself and look inside others. Psychoanalysis is that view, that window into the psychic reality of a person that we, most of us, live our lives in unawareness. Only poetry, some literature, you get at that kind of thing. And psychoanalysis tries to. I think the future of our institute and the future of psychoanalysis are bound up together. And we have to be prepared to give something to psychoanalysis. I think you make sacrifices for psychoanalysis. And I think that if psychoanalysis gets closed down, I don't mean it by a kind of a century or a government, but if it gets closed down intellectually, I think that we are in a very dangerous position in this world, because the life of the mind is what psychoanalysis really tries to preserve. What does that mean for LAISPS? I think that means losing our selfish motives. I think it means uniting with all other people who have a sense of psychoanalysis, unconscious motivation, psychic reality, fantasy. And we have to join with those people in a very almost aggressive way. Not only simply to hold on to what we have, but to lead the way. I think it lead the way to a kind of intellectual intellectual freedom. And for me, psychoanalysis has always meant that. A kind of intellectual search, intellectual freedom. And what is, old ego psychology, what does tearing down resistances mean? What's the resistance of it tearing down? The resistance to knowing, to seeing, to feeling, to thinking. And that's what the fight is on. That fight is a cultural fight now. It's not simply a fight in psychology or social work or psychiatry. It's a cultural fight. And the sooner we become aware of that and enter into the cultural arena, then I think we may be able to save free thinking, open thinking, democracy. We had somebody, some people who want to join our institute. And what they like are our candidates, possibly. I can only believe that we've fostered an atmosphere in the institute of freedom, of thinking, that we haven't tried to stop, but we haven't tried to promote any one theory. But we know what our history is. We don't ever forget our history.
Sharing a rich history, Drs. Jean Sandville and Joel Shore discovered the idea of psychoanalysis at an early age. Their individual and joint contributions as scholars, writers, teachers, and clinicians have received international recognition in both academic and analytic circles. Their writings and teachings reflect a lifelong evolution of the analyst as student, forever curious, open, and excited to new ideas and new possibilities.
My journey began, I guess, at age 14, when I discovered in my father's library Carl Menninger's book, The Human Mind. And being probably somewhat worried about my own at that age, I read it from cover to cover and thought, that's for me. That's a really interesting world that he's describing. And that's what I would like to do. I don't know whether it's generally known, but just a few years after Freud made his first visit to the United States, to Clark University in Worcester, some social workers in that part of the world decided to found a school of social work based on the principles that they had learned from Sigmund Freud. And so in 1918, the Smith College School of Social Work was begun. And then the war came along, and that's what brought me actually to California. I had a husband who was shipping out from the West Coast, and if I were going to see him at all, I had to be out here where the ship came in. So I came out and I worked for family agencies first, and there too, the consultant was psychoanalytic, and Sam Futterman, some of you may know, was my consultant. And so after a while doing that, Sam was appointed director of the VA Mental Health Clinic, which was at the time peopled with all of the analysts in LA. They were very much around and with us. And so I went to the VA clinic and enjoyed that experience for a while. I was invited to teach at UCLA School of Social Welfare. And again, partly it was a great demand on the part of the students for someone who would be psychoanalytically oriented. And that's what I was brought in to do. I developed the the first time there was a second year to the program, I was brought in to develop that program. And I was there for some 40 years with only a few years intermission when the McCarthy era came along and some of us didn't like that too well, so we sat it out for a few years. So somewhere in the 60s, I would say, a group of us began thinking about how nice it would be to have our own psychoanalytic institute. So we first were kind of a study group ourselves. All the people that you all have been interviewing and know were part of that. We would meet sometimes in each other's homes. I remember quite a few meetings at the Hacker Clinic, actually. We used their resources. And we dreamed up and eventually made actual an institute. And that was exciting. Joel's history was in some ways like mine, in that he too had discovered psychoanalysis very early in his life, knew that he wanted to do it, and he was an exceedingly bright young chap, sort of ahead of his grades always, and had worked in New York, actually with some of the same people that I worked with, although we didn't know each other there. But he was part of that Chris group, Ernst Chris, and we knew quite a few of the same people, but we actually never met there. Joel went through training at the New York Psychoanalytic, only to be told that he had to promise never to practice. And so, of course, he dropped out. And he was one of the founders of the first non-medical training institute in the United States, the NPAP, which is still actually in existence. I met Joel through Carl Sachs, who was living right down the street from us at that time. He was just visiting at that point and went back to England. And then a few years later, after Michael Bauman died, he came here and made his stay. And he was part of the group that founded the Institute. He was in on those early meetings and would be certainly one of the people that you would be interviewing today if he had stayed around a few more years, because he was very much involved. The initial group was indeed a diverse group, with a few exceptions. Most of us had our training the bootleg way. Now Joel, as I've already told you, had training at the New York Psychoanalytic, had training in Chicago, but the same thing happened. They could get trained, but they couldn't be designated psychoanalysts, and they couldn't really practice. The rest of us, like Ernie and Norm and the Caruths and so on, had not had formal training. But you know, while the analysts were very busy turning us down and shutting the door as far as official training was concerned, they were really quite willing to let us sit at their feet in seminars and workshops, and they would supervise us. They weren't officially allowed to, but there were quite a few of them who wanted and were very willing to do that. So each of us, you see, had different kinds of experiences. There was probably relatively little commonality other than that we all loved psychoanalysis and that we were determined that there should be a way for non-medical people to become officially trained and officially recognized as analysts. It was heady wine, that period, because we were, in spite of whatever differences there were, we were bound together by this common wish, and by a lot of energy went into it. A lot of time and energy went into those meetings and into planning and actualizing the Institute. Well, the future is probably not like the past. When I came into this field, psychoanalysis was enormously popular. Some of the really good thinkers in our field, and I would count Otto Kernberg among those, speaks to the petrification of institutes. That, and I'm painfully aware of this myself. I've founded a few other institutes besides this one. And there is a time, such as I have described, in which excitement carries the day, when you're planning and you're getting it started, and then something sets in that is problematic in all institutes. I don't think that there's anything unique about this. And so you have to keep beginning anew. As Michael Ballant would say, you have to aim at new beginnings. We're getting a different kind of patient than we used to. We're extending ourselves to treat people who once upon a time would not have been considered suitable for psychoanalysis. They are often people who are early, either deprived or traumatized, and different approaches are probably indicated. So in the international, on the House of Delegates where I have served the last 2 years, there has been a committee working on the crisis of psychoanalysis. And I drew up some 13 points that indicated that there is a crisis, and then I drew up 13 more points about how you might meet that crisis in order to transcend it. I'm hopeful, and I'm hopeful mainly because I think psychoanalysis is just the most interesting show in town.
Born in Philadelphia, a practical, down-to-earth founder, Dr. Martin Reiser devoted himself to the educational organization and establishment of LAISPS as a viable institution. While still serving the institute, Marty felt a new calling. He retired from LAISPS and became the chief psychologist of the Los Angeles Police Department. Utilizing his theoretical and clinical skills, he developed techniques in working with witnesses in major crime cases and hostage negotiations. Marty became known as the father of police psychology.
When I found that there was no opportunity for analytic training for non-physicians, I was kind of surprised, and yet felt that this wasn't the way it should be. And got to talking with Norman Oberman, and he had been involved in a study group for a while, as I recall, and he agreed too that something should be done about that, and we decided to see if we couldn't found some kind of a training group in analysis. Before we did that, we had some conversations with the principals of both of the LA medical analytic groups to see if there was some way that we could be affiliated with them, and of course the answer was no at that time. And after kicking it around and a lot of discussion, we decided to start as a component society of the LA County Psychological Association. And so we started with the Los Angeles Society of Psychoanalytic Psychology, a chapter of LACPA. And then finally, I think it was about 1970, it was decided to establish the institute of the society. It was kind of a backwards approach to things, but that was the way it seemed to be feasible politically and practically at that time. The institute adopted a typical Freudian approach, but a very eclectic kind of point of view, acknowledging that psychoanalysts could come from a wide variety of backgrounds and specialties and interests. For many years, it was quite a struggle to get students in each class, getting people interested. We were a new institute. We didn't have a reputation or a name at that time. And so it was a kind of a long, slow attempt to get established. And I think that by the fact we're talking now, that finally happened.
As a founding member, Dr. Charles Ansell brought his varied background in law and politics, psychology and theology, Literature and Psychoanalysis to LAISPS. Charlie has exemplified the mature analyst informed by his own imagination and the culture at large. His work taps into the creative process which flows through all fields in art and science. Retired now, Charlie has been the editor of our newsletter, The Free Associate. He has written books on psychology and poetry, psychology and theology, psychoanalysis and art.
I realized that I needed something more, and I went to see Reich, who was a psychoanalyst, and he referred me for analysis. And my analyst at that time was himself a graduate student at Columbia, and he said to me, why don't you do that? So I matriculated at Columbia and became a doctoral candidate, and I got my doctorate degree at Columbia University, following which I went for 4 years in the Analytic Training Institute. So by the time I finished in New York, which is 1960, I've had 8 years of solid discipline training in psychology and in psychoanalysis. And I came here prepared to practice a profession that was disciplined. And to my great shock, I found this place to be a wild place. I was an oddity, an analyst. No psychologist out here was trained for analysis. And I was an eccentric. And so I was being invited all over to explain the analytic point of view. And wherever I went, I lost. Because I was up against the Gestalt, the theater. I was up against things that you can't demonstrate psychoanalysis in a panel discussion of other disciplines. You can't do that. And so I looked around for analytic colleagues, and I discovered head of Bogar, who was trained with Franz Alexander in Chicago, whose work I knew in Chicago. And an analyst in New York referred me to Ernie Lawrence's associate. And I met Ernie Lawrence then. And I discovered Marty Reiser, who went to my analytic institute, the Philadelphia branch. So he and I asked to meet with Hedda and Ernie and others to establish a prototype of the MPAP that we had in New York, which is how it got started. When it comes to psychoanalysis, I see that as still another organized intellectual system that existed alongside others. And one must approach that with some critical intelligence. I find the division among analysts to be interesting, but in a sense, disheartening. Object relations people got the truth. Drive theory got the truth. Storrow with inner subjectivity, they all got the truth. And the degree to which they believe that they have the truth, I'm not so sure that this augurs too well for the future of a coherent psychoanalysis. I think psychoanalysis as a system of psychology stands head and shoulders above all other psychologists. This is the only crap game in town. The Institute, I feel, our Institute, is a first-rate demonstration of giving audience to all these views. I'd like to think they do. I have not been part of an instructional faculty for years, so I really don't know what's going on. But I can only relieve myself of the questions that have haunted me about beware of politicizing an ideology, beware of politicizing an idea. Psychoanalysis will change with every generation. And if I were to say that's too bad, there ought to be a strong unified one, I'm really being an Orthodox Jew, you know, and I should be reformed, you know. I should say there's, you know, the interesting, when those of you who know the prayer books, you know that in the prayer book they say, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. So why don't they say the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? Why do they give each one of the patriarchs that? And it's because each one had a different God. And each generation is going to have to find their own God. And each generation of analysts are going to have to find the truth that works for them. To have lived through an intellectual history that up until now encompassed the great ideas of this century, from Marxism to Freud, which were the, I mean, anybody ask me the three great minds of this century, obviously they're Marx, Freud, and Einstein, but I can't talk Einstein, but I can talk Marx and Freud. So I wish psychoanalysis well. I wish the analyst of the future is a seasoned man. I think a guy, an analyst who doesn't know his theater, who doesn't know literature, and doesn't know Shakespeare, and doesn't know theology, is poor. Really poor. When I think of what Freud's assets were, he knew mythology, he knew history, he knew the theater, he knew literature. And it's permeated, it permeates his work. He wouldn't have had the Oedipal theory had he not known Greek drama. So we were the Philistines among our people, you know. They've got to have some cultural acquisition, some cultural familiarity. Because to come to it as a bright-eyed graduate student is switching from mathematics to psychoanalysis, that's live burial.
Dr. Clifton Carruth is an active and respected member of the psychological and psychoanalytic community. As a founder, Cliff's impact on the group came in his quiet acceptance and appreciation of their individual differences. Cliff personifies two of the most important qualities in the analyst, integrity and kindness.
I remember the first time coming across the phrase, Sigmund Freud, that dirty old man. And it was when I read that chapter that it was just so alive. I mean, I literally felt a thrill as I was reading, and I thought, my God, I'd never heard of Freud before. And I thought, my God, this guy really knows it. And so I decided that's the field I want to go in. And subsequently read some more of Freud's writings. Of course, the first one was The Psychopathology of Everyday Life, and that wowed me. I really got interested in training and teaching. Then I began to develop my own private practice and do more reading, more training, went into analysis myself. As you all know, it was a very powerful, profound experience. Was frustrated by the lack of analytic training for non-medical people. So sought analytic supervisors, some of whom would make the point, you mustn't say that I'm giving you directed readings or in any sense training you, because that's against the rules. And somewhere along the line, our institute began to develop the society first, and then out of the society, the institute, by which time I heard of it through some friends very early on within the first year, and realized that some of my colleagues and buddies were involved, and so I went right to it myself. Early on in my career, I was interested not only in psychoanalysis and learning as much as I could to become an analyst, but also in the dissemination of the word, I guess you'd say, the knowledge. And I've always enjoyed doing supervision and training, and was looking forward to that. You know, here we had our own institute. It wasn't a medical institute. It was broadly based. All the professions, we all felt very good about that. You know, I was, quotes, the Kleinian. There were other people of other persuasions, ego psychology, some very orthodox psychoanalysis. So we had quite a mixture. It was interesting because, indeed, as we planned courses and so on, it's, you know, how are these going to be done? And we never really got into discussions of great rancor. Disagreement from time to time, but it was very stimulating. The early years, for, oh my goodness, a year or two maybe, We met twice a week, and it was the kind of thing you looked forward to, not like, oh, another meeting. And then eventually, 75, I was elected president of the board for the first time. That was special, too. That was special, too. Because I remember at the end of the year when they hand you the plaque and so on, I felt very moved, and someone said, what's it like? And I said, well, I think this is what you call one of those real peak experiences.
Dr. Rudolf Eckstein is a world-renowned psychoanalyst, scholar, author, and lecturer. Born in Vienna, he brought his inheritance of early psychoanalytic study to LAISPS. Rudy escaped the Nazis, taking with him a profound understanding of how a life can be broken and repaired. In his dedicated work with children, he lived close to the fairy tale, the myth, and the lullaby. He developed a rare capacity to understand the unconscious in narrative and to express meaning in his gift of storytelling.
Once when I had to leave Vienna, I promised myself I will never go back, I will never speak German again, I will learn English, and I will leave for England at first and later for America. And after a while I realized I cannot do it. I cannot get rid of the language of my parents, my mother. This Vienna constantly remained in my mind, and I like to describe the environment. 10 minutes from there was Berggasse. There was Berggasse, and in the Berggasse, Eichhorn, Sigmund Freud, Anna Freud, it was the way to go. And on the way, I would find the place where Alfred Adler lived. And if I went a few steps further, it was the university. And in the university, where the philosophy professors and psychology professors that gave me now a new struggle. Would I believe in Freud? Would I believe in Alfred Adler? Would I believe in Gomperz and Reininger and Schlick and Bühler and Charlotte Bühler, the teachers of my time? And I realized as years would go by, could I succeed to put all that in my mind and make out of myself somebody who had accepted the best of all of his teachers and become myself? I was somebody who had already spent some 10 years before in Topeka, Kansas, where with the Menninger brothers we had a psychonic island in the midst of the wheat fields. It was almost unbelievable. When our children grew older and I started to ask myself, where will they go to school? What kind of education would they have? Kansas and Kansas University was not quite enough. And I remember the old phrase, go west, young man. I once thought Los Angeles would be the city of the angels. But was it really the city of the angels? We know enough from that city to know that even though one can try to have a little island right here in Brentwood, is it the city of the angels? One only need to read every day the Los Angeles Times or listen to the news to know that in some way the world hasn't changed. It was a difficult world where I grew up. It was a difficult world when I came to other places after I had left Vienna, but it was a world that gave me a chance to become myself. And I think if one could ask oneself what psychoanalysis, the work of Freud and of Anna Freud, and of all the students of Freud,
has done for me and for the students of psychoanalysis, we found our own world. We knew from where we were coming, but we also knew slowly where we are going. This home has seen now students from these different psychoanalytic institutes, and of all of them it could say that they are really institutes that were founded by exiles. If you think of Hedda Bolgar and I had the same professors at the University of Vienna. If you think of Grotjan, if you think of whoever the name is, there were people who tried to restore what they had lost. And some of us swore occasionally, I will never go back, as I did once. And then something came, Europe has changed, and the Germany was not anymore the Germany of Hitler, Austria was not fascist anymore, and the days of Mussolini and Franco and Hitler and Göring, etc., etc., and Horthy were gone by. We came back again to countries that restored the idea of a republic and the idea of democracy. Some of what we brought back was the heritage that once we took out. We brought them back, except some of it were now our own contributions. And I know what pleasure it is for me to know that at the University of Vienna and in the Psychoanalytic Institute in Vienna and in the Adlerian Institute are contributions of ours, books of mine, articles of mine. A bridge was restored which was once broken off. And I sometimes puzzle when I think of these old days, what it takes to first destroy a bridge, a psychological bridge, and then restore it. And this restoration process, of course, is an inner process, a psychological process. So that when you go through this house, you cannot help but find in it the past, the present, and the future. What happened in America, there are two things that go. It's an enormously big country, and the Americans sometimes want to give up the time that it takes, for example, to be truly an analyst or be truly a historian. And they thought of shortcut measures that would be cheaper, that could be used for people who could not pay otherwise, or for people who were impatient. So we see a variety of movements and of important people who have contributed, but it's another world that they contributed to. They want to go the fast road. But I think that was true for every culture, that after a while, the younger generation want to go a faster pace. And there are some of us who don't need to, and there are some of us who have always enough students who want to go the old way. We don't dilute. As a Viennese, I would like to put it this way. When I go and drink a glass of wine, no watering down. It's got to be real wine. And when it comes to analysis, it's got to be real analysis. What happened to the teachings of a Marx? What happened to the teaching of a LaSalle? What happened to the teaching of a Lenin? So that if you would go to Russia and ask, where is Lenin? Or if you go to Germany and ask, where is Marx? Or when we go wherever we are, where is Freud? And for some of us, it is important to maintain in the midst of a watered-down culture something that defends the heritage. I have somewhere some playing cards that my father used in Vienna. Nobody plays with these cards anymore, they're completely different. But at least I have a package of them. And occasionally I meet someone who can play that kind of game and restore the past. There are some for whom tradition counts. And the defense of tradition although if you like to hear psychoanalytic tradition, is terribly important, even though it is quite clear to me that sometimes this tradition will not survive for all the people for whom it was meant. And maybe they then will create their own traditions and will defend the tradition, whether it is the style of building, whether it is the kind of flowers one has here and there, whether one teaches one's children this or that. Tradition, tradition.
To face the unknown, the dark regions in one's own self, is perhaps the most painful challenge in becoming an analyst. Dr. Itamar Yahalom, an internationally known analyst and scholar, reveals his infinite depth and awe in grasping the complexity of the human condition. Itamar never lets us forget that it is only in our own capacity to tolerate our helplessness that we can make contact with those we try to heal. Itamar suffered the atrocities of anti-Semitism early in his life, the traumatic separation from his homeland and family at the age of 7 marks the beginning of his analytic search.
Father holding a big bundle, I holding a little one, and went on a wagon away. Mother kissed me and hugged me and hid her tears. Father did something that I never saw him before. He hugged Mother in the public and had tears in his eyes, and we left. I remember it, asking myself, where is the God that Father is praying every day? Where is all our life organization? Why should this happen to me? Why should it happen to Mother? There were other children left. He told me that the house and the factory that was there is not ours anymore. Why was it taken away? Who is taking it away? I was filled with questions that were incomprehensible. My mind couldn't grasp it. But I left. I went when I was 7 years old and had to leave Mother with Father. Created in me, I believe, looking back, a strong wish to see what's going on in human beings. What are human beings about? My search for understanding, my training, my teaching, it was based on the search and on the belief that they are healing powers that are as strong as the destructive powers. We have just to find a way to reach them. To reach them means, that's how I still today believe, to reach them means to find the contact, the very early or maybe infinite contact in the human being, that what we call mutual rhythms, but they are infinite, and we are terrified because that infinite is indescribable, and we are confronted with a constant fear, where will we end up? I believe that the psychoanalytic movement, as a movement, is terrified of that inability to reach the human growth anywhere that one wants to describe. and we are terrified with our lack of knowledge to reach it. It is interesting, and some people accuse me or blame me for being a mysticist, what I am not, but I appreciate the mystical movement who said, when we don't know something, we have one answer. And they had a word that was teiku, tishbi yeterets kushiot ve'ayot, what you don't know, tishbi, and tishbi was a no term. It was, some people say it's the Messiah, some people say it's God, but they had a boundary. They built a boundary for their incomprehensible questions. We struggle. I think, and if I accuse the movement, I include myself in it. I know how afraid we are if we don't know the answer. I know how we are afraid we don't know how to reach a patient. I know how much we want to build something, and we accept rigid, comfortable ways because it gives us at least a freedom of peace. And that I cannot reconcile. I don't see any other way than to communicate that there is no any different, better way than to reach those, whatever we call it, unconscious rhythm, mutuality, growing forces. There is no other method than psychoanalysis. And unconscious included. I came to Los Angeles by invitation. My life was, I always traveled by invitation, whatever it means. The invitation to come to help the new building of the day treatment for severely disturbed children and their families, what I did in Chicago twice, what I had with Bettelheim, where I left because of that. I didn't agree that children can be really well treated, separate from parents. And he couldn't accept that, so I built a day treatment in Chicago. And then I was invited by Rice Davis. They planned to build a similar thing to have that kind of day treatment. And of course I gave workshops and this and that. And when Norm Obermann, I remember, asked me, don't you want to join an institute that we are going to build or we start? I thought to myself and said, I am afraid of the organized institutions, but the wish to exchange thoughts, learning, workshops, was so important to me that I thought it's worth the danger of the institution that creates rigidities and unnecessary rules. And I said yes.
Dr. Milton J. Horowitz, affectionately known as Mike, was born in Brooklyn and began his analytic career sitting around the kitchen table listening to his mother's and aunt's homespun wisdom about life and people. From there, he went on to graduate from the City College of New York. He received his PhD from Menninger's, and leaving Topeka, Kansas in 1952, Mike became chief psychologist at Western Reserve in Cleveland and director of Rice Davis Child Study Center in Los Angeles. From his earliest days around the kitchen table to his time at Menninger's, Mike experienced and believed in the equality of lay analysts and medical analysts. True to the values he learned as a young athlete, he was, in the finest sense, a great team player. Mike brought his fair-minded, open-hearted, and generous spirit to the group. As a leader, he gave us all his enthusiastic support, encouraging us to overcome difficulties and win. We sadly lost Mike after his valiant fight against cancer just days before he was to be filmed. Fortunately, he lived to see the official acceptance of LAISPS in IPA, a high point in his career. Milton J. Horowitz died on March 31st, 1996, leaving us a legacy of courage. Dr. Hedda Bolgar was raised with a social consciousness that became a central force in her life. Alleviating the suffering of others has been a repetitive and constant theme in her existence. Besides her political work, she has been involved in the creation of LAISPS, the California School of Professional Psychology, and the Wright Institute. Her love, compassion, and humanity is not only reflected in her sense of responsibility toward the community, but in her nurturing work as an analyst, teacher, and supervisor. Hedda is attuned to the delicate and the fragile. Hers is a light touch.
I got my first psychoanalytic training, according to my mother, prenatally, because as students, they ate in the student cafeteria, and the people they happened to be eating with were the students around Carl Jung. And so every lunch conversation centered around the great exploits of the great professor and the wonderful interpretation of the dreams. This was my prenatal analytic experience, but developed in my very early years the consciousness of the suffering of other people. It was a chronic theme, and the need to do something about it. And with it, the inevitable political development, conviction, learning about it. Obviously, my family was left-wing, socialist, communist, Marxist, whatever. The next few years were essentially the years of big political events, revolutions everywhere at the end of World War I, certainly in Central Europe, communist regimes, idealism, the new world, there would never be a war again. It was all very exciting. So Vienna for a while was a great time. That's a place where Rudi Eckstein and I met in the socialist youth movement. He was much more active than I was, but he was there. And then the Nazis, who had taken over power in Germany in 1933, I'm now talking about 34, 35, 36 in Vienna. Some of us saw the handwriting on the wall. Some of us became very actively involved in fighting it. I started publishing some anti-Nazi articles, some locally, some in German refugee publications, which appeared in Paris and in Amsterdam. And that created a very dangerous situation for myself, knowing what was coming. So while we were talking about those things, we also thought it was time to think of leaving. And on the spur of the moment, I wrote to Sam Beck at Michael Reese Hospital in Chicago that I would like an internship. I would like a postdoctoral internship. I had my PhD by then. And I would like to learn about American psychology. And much to my surprise and delight, I got a letter back and he said, fine, why don't you come in July? And in March, the Nazis came in. Hitler marched into Vienna. Blue sky, March, gorgeous weather, streets lined with people. So-called spontaneous, popular enthusiasm. I left that day. decided that while everybody is enthusiastic, I can get out. I did spend 2 days or 3 days in Washington with a friend. My first encounter with American life. And I have come out of an armed camp. The machine guns were stacked up at every corner, and the planes were flying overhead, and the tanks were rolling through the streets in Vienna. Just for the 2 days that I was there, before from the official Angelus to the day Hitler walked in. So it was an armed camp. So here was the White House, and there was the uniform inside, anywhere. This was 1938. I walked to a door, and there was a little cardboard notice, and it said, "Please do not enter," handwritten, "President's private quarters." Not a guard, no uniform, nothing. That seemed like heaven. No paranoia. Out of that, I finally landed at my Clarice and started my postdoctoral internship. And this is really the first time when I saw the power of the medical profession. I finally ended up at the end of the war as the chief psychologist of the Veterans Administration Clinic in Chicago. This is now 1945 or 6. And we now have veterans en masse who need psychotherapy. And suddenly, it was okay for psychologists to be therapists. I then finally landed the full-time job at the university. And at that point, having taught courses on psychoanalytic theory, having supervised people in doing therapy, the passion began to develop. And I wanted to be in analytic training. Well, there was no way that anybody could see that a non-medical person could get analytic training, except the Chicago Institute was willing to negotiate, headed by Franz Alexander, who was convinced that psychoanalysis was not here to stay as we knew it, that it had to expand. At that time, most members of the American Psychoanalytic Association would not analyze the psychologist because it could be interpreted as training and they would be kicked out of the association. Alexander negotiated with the psychology department and with the of the University of Chicago and managed to persuade his faculty at the Institute and the powers that be that if they trained a few people who were faculty members, it would probably be okay. So, one day, I found my name on the bulletin board of the Institute listed as a special student. By that time, I was in analysis. My analyst was an ego psychologist, but she was also a human being. And while she analyzed me very much according to the text, and I always knew that something was missing and that we were scratching the surface only. She also sang a lullaby to me once. So there was some indication that it could be done. I finished with the Institute. I never got a certificate, but Alexander invited me to come with him to Los Angeles to work on a project for which he had just gotten a big Rockefeller grant. The project was to be the study of the psychoanalytic process, no less. I wrote a letter to all the members of the Los Angeles Society for Clinical Psychology and said that I was sitting on wonderful material. And if they were interested in having some kind of a colloquium or seminar, discuss it with me, I would be delighted. The person who picked it up most was Ernie Lawrence. And he came, and a lot of other people came, and Ernie and I became very good friends, and we also talked a lot about analysis. There was some talk about there are other people who want to be analysts, not everybody can go to Chicago. Or any other place where maybe, like in Topeka, where they would train non-medical people, isn't it time to start an institute? We started it as still part of a psychological organization of the LA County Psychological Association. However, we knew that we were going to be interdisciplinary. And one evening at a business meeting, Irma Yahalom, God bless him, said, if this is an interdisciplinary institute, why do we have to be part of a division of a psychological organization? And nobody had thought of that. And so we went independent. And that was really the birth of LAISPS. I feel a tremendous amount of love for this institute. It's been my home and the center of my life for many years now, 25, more or less. I have seen it grow, I have seen it develop a richness that most institutes, I don't think, have. That the things that we are talking about and are concerned about, our intense involvement with the IPA and their real struggle with where psychoanalysis is going, and their incredible naivety in some places, and rigidity and immovability in other places, I think we are way ahead, and I think we are going to be extremely active in changing perhaps psychoanalysis in the world. There are signs that this is happening. There are a few people who are very courageously speaking up in IPA circles. Our own Jean Sandville is one of them. This world that we are training people into will have to be aware of a lot of things. We have to be aware of a lot of things in this world. One of them, the Wright Institute motto, that there is no individual without a society, and there is no society without an individual. And unless we become aware of cultural and social aspects of everybody's life, conscious and unconscious, we are not going to be able to analyze people. If we are not able to tolerate our own complexity, but see the complexity in the world and in our patients. If there is the striving for an ideal that I don't think is an ideal, which is sort of a unitary, one-size-fits-all psychoanalysis, we're going to just die. The fact that we still struggle so desperately with having minorities join us is a outright result of having practiced analysis in the old way. I don't think we have enough to offer to people who are in a chronic political and economic struggle. It's difficult today. But I have always followed Eleanor Roosevelt in her statement that it's better to light a candle and to curse the darkness. And I think when we started the Institute in the face of medical prejudice, I think we are very good at lighting candles.
We in the Los Angeles Institute and Society for Psychoanalytic Studies have waited 27 long years for this wonderful moment, and we are elated. It is a great honor and privilege for which we express the utmost gratitude to be accepted into the International Psychoanalytical Association, the organization that Sigmund Freud created to maintain the highest standards of psychoanalytic teaching, research, and practice. He said, and I quote, "Psychoanalysis falls under the head of psychology, not of medical psychology in the old sense, nor of the psychology of morbid processes, but simply of psychology, This is what our institute represents, pure and simple. Established in 1968 as the first interdisciplinary psychoanalytic institute in Los Angeles, our society has fought vigorously to earn the opportunity to contribute its unique creativity from the behavioral, social sciences, and humanities to the international psychoanalytic legacy. We owe so much to our training analysts, members, and candidates who have made LAISE worthy of being here today. I wish that time would allow me to mention all of you individually, so I would like you now to all stand. You all stand, everyone here from LAISE. We look forward to participating actively in IPA and to helping it become more of the kind of democratic institution that finally allowed us to be a member society. We are dedicated to the principle of welcoming enthusiastically the participation and creativity of all qualified psychoanalysts throughout the world. Thank you.